goodness. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Thank you for that greeting. It is good to be in the house of the Lord, amen, and come together. It's finally winter. I'm not going to lie. Like, I really would love white Christmas, the idea of white Christmas, but the 70 degrees last week was kind of super nice. So this morning it was a bit of a shock to walk out. But it is good to be able to gather together and just praise our Father, and we can just come, whatever our week has looked like, whatever our morning has looked like, we can just come and be in the presence of God and know that we are welcome here. So Father, we just thank you for this morning, for this time. Let us just be able to set aside the distractions that have already been pulling at us today, Lord, and just come together and honor your greatness and the goodness that you are in our lives, Father. And Lord, this Sunday of Advent, as we still work towards Christmas and the excitement of that, Father, just let us pause and remember that you, in all of your glory, took on flesh and came among us, Lord, to live our messy, crazy lives, so that you would be able to know us and we would be able to know you on a level that is just almost incomprehensible. Lord, we just thank you for this morning, and we praise you, Father. So I invite you to stand as we worship our King.
Restore every heart that is torn.
his breath worship you.
Light the candle of joy. Come, joy, lighten our spirits.
This fourth Sunday, we light the candle of love. Come, love, shine in all.
This one.
Come, Jesus, be born in us. Come, Lord, set us free. Come, God, rule in our hearts and teach us to love each other as you love us.
Come. So this is it. This is the countdown. We know what's coming at the end of the week. Actually, we're going to get a bit of a start on that this evening, the Nativity. The first of the Nativities is this evening at 7. Again, Tuesday evening at 7, and then on Christmas Eve at 5 and at 7. And then at 9 o'clock, we'll have a kind of an intimate candlelight service here in the sanctuary. And if you have people that would prefer not to be outside for the Nativity, we're also live streaming it inside. So that's also an option. And at this point, we're not asking people to worry so much about signing up. That was only in case we needed to get in touch with you, in case the weather was bad and we needed to reschedule. But God willing, I may have just jinxed us. The week looks good as far as the weather goes. So we thank God for that. When we're talking about this week, there are these two elements, the story of this week. There had these elements of the big, powerful movers and shakers and the lowly. And in Micah's time, the prophet Micah, his time was a quieter time in some ways, but like all the prophets, there was the grand drama of what was happening with the nations, with Israel being invaded, being torn into exile, returning, being worried about what local kingdoms and are going to do around them and whether God would be protecting them and wondering what the future held. Sometimes I think we too are in a situation where our lives are being moved or shaken by those who have the big levers. You know, whether it's in Washington, D.C. or London or Paris or Moscow or Beijing, or whether it's different organizations or agencies or even what's happening locally. But in all of that, we feel like we can be powerless. We can be small. We're being rocked and moved and shaken by those up there, and we hope that God gives them sense and that things turn around. And this was true in Micah's time and Luke's time, and it's true in our time too. From Micah, the 5th chapter. "But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrath, who have one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return, and the people of Israel. And he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, and the majesty of the name of his Lord his God. And they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace. If the Assyrians come into your land and tread upon your soil, we will raise against them 7 shepherds and 8 installed as rulers." And then from Luke, the 1st chapter, Mary visits Elizabeth. "In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with loud cry, 'Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord.'" In these situations, you have this Bethlehem, and we forget that the full name of Bethlehem is Bethlehem Ephrathah, because it didn't fit in the song, right? Oh, little town of Bethlehem Ephrathah. How, you know, it just didn't work. So we forget that part. Bethlehem really means house of bread, but it also can mean house of war. So when you say, oh, little town, it would be like, oh, little town of worthless war, or little town of little bread. When you add the word Ephrath on it, that actually means fruitful. So you could have the town of fruitful bread, the little town of fruitful bread. So this is just this little town. In that time, that would be a town that would be like, when we joke about an insignificant little place. Oh, I live in this place, and it's so small, it doesn't even have a stoplight. Does that sound familiar? Nothing significant is going to come from this place. all the significant things are going to happen someplace else. There was one writer who was talking about it. I wonder whether Micah was jealous because the major prophets, Micah's a minor prophet, like Habakkuk and Jonah and a couple of the other ones. But if Jeremiah and Isaiah were the major prophets. Like, they get all the fanfare. They get all the things. They're doing all this stuff. And Micah's got this little thing, little insignificant, talking about a little insignificant town, but one where something really, really, really important is going to happen. And then you have the story of Elizabeth and Mary. Now, Elizabeth and Zechariah, Elizabeth is the mother of John the Baptist. So the babe that leaps in the womb, it's almost like John the Baptist is recognizing Jesus even before the two of them were born. But here's the thing. Elizabeth was older, and she was known throughout the community as being barren. So from a barren woman, suddenly there's a fruitfulness. There is giving birth of one who's going to pave the way for the ministry of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And Mary talks over and over again of she was a nobody. She was of low estate. There was nothing special about her, nothing particularly significant about her, and in her town, and suddenly finding herself pregnant. And the whole story then is, out of this lowliness, God is able to do great things. Out of what we think might be insignificant or infertile or not able to have something happen, God has brought about something that's absolutely incredible. I mean, just to understand the scope of this, just imagine yourself sitting in your living room, watching the football game, watching the Hallmark Channel, and boom, an angel appears and asks you to give birth to God. How would you respond? I mean, and the first response, like, who, me? What? What are you talking about? This is not possible. Surely this is something so big, so momentous, so overwhelming. It has, I'm sorry, you got the wrong address. You know, this is the wrong place. And I'm the wrong gender. But God can do miracles, right? I don't know. And this is not what we're talking about. We're talking about giving birth to God, because isn't that what the season is about? About God being born in our lives, in our hearts, once again. And if God, if through the angel you are asked, will you give birth to God? As we are preparing this week, as we are going to the manger, we're going to that stable, we're going to welcome the babe that is not just the babe, but is also the Lion of Judah, the lowly, fragile, vulnerable babe that is also the Lord of heaven and earth, through whom God created everything, and asks for us to be like Elizabeth and like Mary and say yes to God. Now, I'm not sure what your life has been like. I mean, there's just lots and lots of different things that will take the starch out of you, or take the dream out of your eye, or don't think too highly of yourself, or, you know, that ways that we get treated where our worthlessness or our vulnerability or our helplessness gets reinforced over and over and over again. But it's precisely in our inability to save ourselves and earth and in heaven that God is able to come in and do what we are not able to do. So that anything in us that says that we are worthless, or that we are helpless, or that somehow God cannot use us, to that part of ourselves, the message comes loud and clear. This is God. Are you willing? And the blessing came when Mary and Elizabeth before her said yes to God. Think about all the different ways that we can say no to God this week. We can do it out of a sense of worthlessness. We can do it out of a sense of low self-esteem. We can do it out of a sense that being told over and over again by people in power that we mean nothing. We can say no from that. We can say no just simply because we fill up our lives with so much busyness and so many preparations and so much fear and anxiety about the things that are going on that we can't possibly say yes because we're afraid that we will be disappointed. We don't have expectations because if you don't expect anything, then you will never be disappointed. And yet, if anything, I hope in this season you're paying attention to your longing, your desire for God. And when the question comes to you, I hope that you will say yes. Amen.
I wanted to take a minute to extend an invitation to really everyone and anyone. The Well has moved to Sunday nights, and I just wanted to share a brief testimony of something that happened there last week. It's meant to be a place of safety, a place of openness, a place to share what's on your heart. And we were joined this past weekend by a gentleman who we know him, but we didn't know him. And he sat with three of us and shared a part of his life. And it was just amazing because through the course of the entire week, I was able to really kind of focus my prayer life on this young man. And it was just so cool to spend time with somebody who was willing to be vulnerable in a place with strangers and to be able to sort of embrace him in that. And I can't even begin to describe how that's created, because honestly, it's only a Holy Spirit creation. It's nothing we can facilitate. And it's just such a blessing to be able to have that opportunity to spend that time with someone and to really be able to focus in on their prayer life. So I just want to encourage you. Tonight we're actually going to go out and support the Nativity, and we'll be in the sanctuary after the Nativity for some discussion. And then next weekend we're going to take advantage of the fact all the college kids are back in town. Going to have a light meal and then take off to this Clark Griswold house down in Parkton that has like outdoor trains and is just like this crazy Christmas experience. But all of this simply for the opportunity to connect and to have community and fellowship and to continue the family that is this church, to the family that is Christ, and the family that is this season. As we move into the song Gloria, I just ask you to really search your hearts for just this proclamation of joy over the season. Amen.
Let's stand.
Thank you.
Lord, as we prepare our hearts to go out and face a world that has lost all perspective of what this time of year is truly about, let our hearts be prepared that each person that we meet might understand that something is different about how we view this time of year and about how we approach our lives. Each person pushing in line, each person on the other side of that counter, Lord, that they would see us as messengers of your glory. Lord, that they would wonder, that they might ask, that we would be prepared to share. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we praise you. And we rejoice in the coming birth of your Son. Lord, be with us and let us be full of your joy as we go out. In Jesus' name we pray.